SoCal Connected is made possible through the generous support of the Amundsen Foundation, serving the Los Angeles community since 1952.
On tonight's SoCal Connected.
He was touched by God. Like, everybody can't do what Obi did.
He just became a track and field legend.
A force to be reckoned with.
Many were gambling on him to go the distance.
They wanted it. They wanted us to win by 100 and some points.
All about points, but we're not thinking about the athlete.
Even if that came at a high cost.
Anybody that's been to the top, they have a hard time when they take that fall.
What happened to LA's Obi Moore? What does it take to be the best? Gold medals, breaking records, you have to earn them and learn life's lessons, hard lessons, overcoming hurdles, making comebacks, and knowing when to pass the baton. One team has been going the distance, dominating the youth track circuit on and off for the past four decades.
Yeah, they're big. And it's almost like they're intimidating because you see maybe 150 kids at one time.
I started coaching youth track back in the early 90s, and they were a big thing then.
If you've lived in Los Angeles for any period of time and you know anything about track and field, either you know somebody who was a Jet, or they had a cousin, or a friend, or a neighbor, somebody knows about the LA Jets.
During its 46-year history, the club has produced over 200 national champions, 65 national record holders, and a three-time Olympic gold medalist. But the competition to stay at the top never stops. Back in the early 70s, there were fewer than a dozen running clubs in the LA area. There are now over 100. The more medals and ribbons, the more successful the team. That puts pressure on coaches and parents to get even the youngest athletes competing at a national level. Children as young as 4 years old can become a Jet. Nobody is turned away.
The girls in my group, what did I say we were doing today? It's our track meeting. We are doing what?
Lighting up the track.
We are lighting up the track today.
Since it was formed in 1973, the team has had the same trio of coaches. The first was Ron Moore. He was a teacher at West Vernon Elementary in South LA when he started the club.
I was the after-school playground director, and that's how I spotted a lot of the good athletes after-school playground. And especially during the summertime, those kids that didn't go swimming were stuck on the playground because they couldn't swim. So I formed a track team during the summer. That's where I found the track stars.
The LA Jets started small, but from the beginning, they were the league's front runners. In just 3 years, nearly all of the team's 15 boys scored at a national level.
It became a well-known track team.
A powerhouse team. 5 years later, Booker Woods formed the girls' team. He's been their coach ever since.
He does still intimidate.
I still tiptoe around him.
I'm not scared, I'm just intimidated. You're a grown woman.
Yeah, well, that's what he instilled, that, you know.
Because even though now that he's older, I just keep waiting at any moment for him to be like, get over here. Like,
stay up there, Alan. I'm running to the back.
You ran 134. You come in here and run 146? That don't make no sense.
Do I look like I got time for that right now? Man, come on.
I'm just a nice guy. And I don't know why anybody would be afraid of me, because I'm the nicest person in the world.
The third to join, James Robertson.
If you do that, you're gonna be in it, okay?
I'll be in the jail.
That's right, you'll be in the jail if you can do that.
James Robertson lost most of his races, but he could make others win. That's what he discovered when he started coaching for the Jets in 1978. He signed up because his son wanted to run track. With Robertson, Woods, and Moore coaching them, the Jets racked up more than 200 national titles.
We get the kids that we have, we train them, and we do the best with what we have, and we've been very successful in doing that.
Do it!
There was nothing elite about them. The kids were scrappy, they had drive, and they had nothing to lose. Coaches were unpaid and still are.
If you think the Los Angeles Jets is just about coaching, it's not. Some of the stories are unbelievable, but Coach Moore paid rent, paid bills, paid everything, you know, over the years.
I have been so far in debt, it's just unbelievable. But, you know, I look and see, how did I survive? And I know what it is, credit cards.
The team not only survived, but thrived. The Jets were taking down elite track clubs from around the country, and they were doing it during the height of South LA's gang wars and crack epidemic.
And we had all the wars with the drugs coming in. We wanted to keep the babies safe, and we had a host of young folk, girls and boys.
One of those boys was Obi Moore. He was fast, really fast.
He had to run to school from the gang member. He had to run home from school from the gang member. So that would make you pretty quick by itself.
The third grader was about to catapult the Jets into the international media spotlight.
Here at the Los Angeles Jets track club, Obi Moore is making history. He's even...
Obi was big. Obi was big all the way from the time he was 7 years old.
Started that young. And I remember he was just a force to be reckoned with.
I know that his gift, it was a gift like from God. He was touched by God. Like everybody can't do what Obi did.
Probably 1987 when I started. And then the next year I ended up going to the Jets.
Obi Moore was only 8. He was beating kids 2 and 3 years older while running everything from the 100 meter sprint to the mile. Baby-faced with a gentle manner, Obi was on his way to becoming one of the best young talents to ever hit the track.
I just feel possessed inside, like I'm He-Man or something. And I get real mad when I start, when somebody's in front of me, I just get real mad. And then I just go out and leave people.
According to Obi's coach, James Robertson, nobody in the history of this club, or any other to his knowledge, has ever run this fast in this age group.
I think his talent is natural. I think he has natural leg speed from the first day that he came out.
Obi broke his first record at 9 years old. It would be the first of 48.
The top Jet I would have to say is Stephen Lewis because he won the Olympics. He would be number one. Obi Moore is the greatest age group athlete ever in the history of age group track and field.
He won the division championship in every age group from 8 to 14 years old.
You have all those different levels. And at every level, Obi Moore was the best in 3 or 4 events at every level, all those levels. Nobody has ever done that.
Coach James put him in the 15 or the 8. He tried to win every race. That's why he was so good. And he dropped him down to 4. He tried to win whatever Coach James did, whatever he put him in.
His signature stride was no cakewalk. He had to work for it. He also had to work to get out from under the shadow of Jets great Stephen Lewis, a 3-time gold medalist.
Stephen Lewis in a time of 43.89. What a run!
In Obi, Robertson saw another shot at Olympic glory.
The whole idea, let's do what Stephen did and let's do it better. And we always got better.
It worked. He was a 6th grade sensation and continued dominating every division through middle school. When Obi aged out of the Jets program, other coaches started circling, including those over at Muir High in Pasadena. the school was dominating the sport.
Because we were so good for so long. It's almost like it was expected, which is surprisingly, and it sounds conceited, but that's what it was.
It felt like the team's rise couldn't go any higher. Then Obi joined.
He came in as a freshman, and everybody talked about him, and he was awesome from day one.
With Obi, Muir continued its winning streak. Few could catch up to the Mustangs, and the national media was taking notice.
High school in Pasadena, the track team has not only one, two, or three, but eight of the fastest sprinters in the entire state of California.
I have people to say, Coach Turner, I'll trade you a pole vaulter for one of your sprinters, or I'll trade you milers for one of your sprinters, or I'll give you two shot putters in a pole vault for one of your sprinters.
By the time he was a sophomore, he was one of the fastest sprinters in the country.
He could run any event. You could put him in the mile, anywhere in the mile. I mean, it was just amazing.
He'll run that mile, or that 2 mile, or that 800, as if it was almost his last race.
If you wasn't on my level, you wasn't even in the race. You was in the race, but you wasn't in my race. Because I'm running after records. So that's how I became a record breaker.
It wasn't just Obi getting attention. Muir High was now considered one of the best track teams in the country. It was the kind of press and status few schools achieve. It also provided Obi some immunity.
I'm not the smartest guy. I'm not dumb at all. But when you are the man, the A horse, you get privileges and you could take advantage of them. I took advantage of them. And then you could always call your coach, hey, coach, you know, I got a D or I need a C to pass that class.
The people would just line up for his autograph. Just mention Obi Moore and he would, I'm talking about up in the press box, the line would be all the way down to the bottom for to get his autograph. He was that well known.
More and more people latched on, Obi can tell you. People were buying him clothes, giving him money.
In the stands, fans would bet on his races. It seemed like everyone around Obi had a lot riding on his wins. So his coaches ran him, and ran him hard for the next 2 years.
But look at this guy run, Dwight. Amazing running down the backstretch, and the crowd appreciates it.
Oh, he's a great athlete, isn't he?
Obi was about to deliver some of the greatest back-to-back wins in the school's history.
Welcome back to the 1996 Penn Relays. Dwight Stones, Craig Masbach, and Gus.
You don't get invited to the Penn Relays. I mean, you got to be a pretty good team to get invited to the Penn Relays.
The Penn Relays is the oldest and most established track and field competition in the United States. And in 1996, the Muir Mustangs got their first invitation to compete.
And Obi Moore will win easily for John Muir High School. They don't even run a best time of the year for themselves, but what an impressive run by Obi Moore. And for only the second time in 12 years, an American high school has won the Penn Relays Boys 4x400 Meter Relay Championship of America.
The Penn Relays gave Muir and his coaching staff bragging rights. Clyde Turner was named National Coach of the Year. But off the track, a different competition was building.
He was still continued with me. He came to my practices, but some of the coaches at Muir, not the head coach, but some of the coaches was at Muir was telling him he didn't really need to do all of that.
I think that was part of the problem. He did have, he was pulled in different directions, especially as he gets to be a senior.
Coach James was training me for big championships like the World Championships and the Olympics. Turner was more focused, or all he did was focus on high school track because he was a high school track coach.
He was caught between the demands of two coaches.
Our coaching staff was very possessive of our athletes. And I think that is definitely a problem. He's mine, no, he's mine. No, he's mine, no, he's mine.
Anytime an athlete is listening to two, three, four people, it's not gonna work.
It's ego. It's people around me, it's coaches, it's my mom, it's all these, you know, different personalities and egos saying, hey, we gotta win this state, we gotta win this, we gotta win. And I should have just set off. Because I didn't think about 5 years from now. I'm thinking about dual meets and Penn Relays and state meets, and it wasn't worth it.
There was another distraction, one involving Coach Turner.
It was always rumors about Turner. I asked him a few different things a few times in junior high school and high school. And of course, he denied it.
A scandal was brewing. It would soon rock Muir High and the world of track. Before it would surface, the sport was about to lose one of its most valuable assets.
Obi had a previous slight injury in one of the previous meets.
He strained a hamstring somewhere in March, and instead of resting, they kept running. So they were excited. They wanted to break the national record in the 4x4.
Yeah. So I ran hurt, and I still ran the fastest time ever on that track as a high schooler hurt.
And a victory for John Muir of Pasadena, a pen relay record, matching the old record by almost 2 seconds.
Obi kept running despite an injury, hoping it would land him at USC.
I felt real good. I'm just coming off injury. And I'm just glad that we came to represent our school, and I'm just proud of our performance.
You feed off crowds and this crowd.
I mean, if you're looking for scholarship kids, you want to give them every chance they get to get the scholarship. So you try to run them all the time.
The wins continued to rack up at Muir.
Back in those days, a lot of things were points. You get points to win the championship.
They wanted it. They wanted us to win by 100 and some points every meet.
But they came with a price.
So maybe those 10 years of breaking all those records, year in, year out, year in, year out, year, for 10 years, maybe just taking a year or two off and just doing something lighter, I might have came back as the new Usain Bolt.
That's what Robertson was telling him to do. Others were saying something different, too invested in Obi the winner.
And he pulled, and that was the end of it. All about points, but not thinking about the athlete.
Once you become a star, that does happen. You get people, everybody tries to take credit for you. And that's, I think he was really bitter about that, where everybody tries to say, do this, do this, do that. Wait a minute, you know, I hear my coach says this and you're telling me something else.
A lot of these athletes that disappear off the scene, that's why they disappear. They get conflicted within themselves and they really don't know what to do. And they're just children, so you really can't blame them.
By the time he graduated from Muir, his body was breaking down. The focus wasn't there. USC didn't work out, so he bounced from school to school. Robertson feared his prodigy was on track to becoming just another casualty of the win-at-all-costs culture permeating the sport. Priorities and allegiances shifted.
Going to track means you run into other coaches. Hey, man, the way you training with Coach James, that don't work no more. So I went through that. So I'm jumping around trying to find a quick fix, and in track and field, there's no quick fixes. Either you put in the work or you lose.
Obi was untethered, the spotlight dimmed. He was yesterday's news.
And how he is, you know, not on top anymore. That's killer. It's not just Obi, but anybody that's been to the top, they have a hard time when they take that fall, a real hard time. That's when depression sets in, and you know, you get suicidal and all that kind of stuff. It's tough. He probably should have gotten some professional help.
The glory days were also fading from Muir High.
I was walking out of the gym and I saw all the Star News people hanging around. And I walked up to Steve Hunt, who was the editor and sports editor. And I said, Steve, what happened? He said, they arrested Clyde. And the first thing I thought of was that he punched somebody out of the CIF office. That's the first thing I thought of.
In 1998, Clyde Turner was arrested, accused of molesting a 15-year-old track athlete.
I had no clue. I was absolutely shocked. I'd worked with the guy since 1979. And I was, whoa. You know, I was absolutely stunned.
Evidence surfaced, showing a school official had been warned about Turner years earlier. A victim's family member accused the school of sacrificing children for a great athletic program. The school claimed it knew nothing.
It was tragic for the city.
The coach was convicted of 2 felony counts, including committing a lewd act upon a child. Muir's winning streak fizzled, So did Obi Moore's. Almost 8 years later, Robertson got a call. It was Obi. He missed running.
And even when he tried to make a comeback, he came back to Coach James, which, you know, says a lot about his faith that he has in Coach James.
Being Obi Moore, oh, he wouldn't have had any problem getting money from people and to support him and while he was training and doing all that. All he needed was his name. And me telling them that, hey, this guy's ready, that would have been enough.
Robertson would sign him up for a meet, and Obi would be a no-show. The cycle repeated.
One of the things that Obi was fearful of is going to a track meet, big track meet, having thousands of people in the stand, and then him coming in fourth place. That would put a dent in his legend, I guess.
Fed up, Robertson says he stopped working with him. Obi couldn't go to the line. The mental toughness wasn't there.
I had evidence that he wasn't stable. I trained this guy, and I'm telling you, we're trained to a point where I knew that he was ready, and then he would disappear for 2 months. So I'm gonna take money from people, and we're gonna have this great comeback, and then have him disappear on these people? My integrity, my character, and my reputation was on the line. We're not gonna do that unless you show me that you're really ready to come back. And all he needed to do to show me is go to a big race and perform. He didn't have to win. He just had to go and perform. It never happened.
If I would have listened to him, my career probably would have been totally different.
When the cheers stop, then it's not good.
What up, man? Everything good? Good to see you, man.
Several of Obi's records still stand. He is considered one of the best young sprinters of all time, and he still attracts a crowd.
What's poppin'? I ain't heard from you, bro. What up, folks? Everything good?
All right.
Good
to see
you. It feels bad going to stadiums where people, man, what are you doing? Where you been? Oh, we heard you in school here. We heard you in school. So that takes a lot out of your spirit when you don't have no answers. Like, man, I've been floating around. I don't know what happened.
Obi and Robertson are speaking again, but not about comebacks. Now, it's about the fate of the Jets.
In the 90s, in 2000, the average was about like 50, 60 boys. And now the last, I'd say 5 years, if we get 25 boys, we have a lot. They're all usually siphoned off by other teams. You know, they recruit the athletes, and before you know it, they're starting a new team, or they're going to another team. And that's the biggest difference.
I think part of the switch happened when football became an all-around, an all-year type of sport. And then I think that took away from the boys program. And then there are some people who do not agree with his coaching style. Things have changed over the years. Kids have changed, parents have changed, and everybody is not out for what worked, you know, back in the 80s and the 90s.
I want to say 85, 75, maybe 65% of these records still stand. That means since 88, I done had a record that Coach James trained me that still stands. These records shouldn't be 30, 40 years old. It's ridiculous, right? So that means what he does works.
The old way of winning is just not as popular as it used to be. Gone with it, the region's love affair with track. The days when crowds packed the stands, big headlines and national spotlights. But that may be changing. The Olympics are returning to Los Angeles in 2028. And the LA Jets believe they have a shot at getting another one of their own on the winner's platform. This time, however, it may be a girl. Fourteen-year-old Spencer Young is one of the nation's top javelin throwers. She even has her own Nike ad.
I'm going to be an overnight success. Even if it takes 10 years.
She's part of a new generation of Jets. Most of them have never heard of Obie Moore, although Robertson wants to change that.
You just have to hope that other kids, they learn from what happened to Obie. And that's why it's important that they get the story out there.
The best don't always win. If you set your goals too high, like I did, when you fall, you might not come back up.
In September, Robertson announced he's stepping back from the Jets. Sonoma Evans is now the head coach for the boys and girls.
Without Coach Woods and Coach James, they have done such a fantastic job. You don't find coaches that last this long in this type of situation. And, it's amazing. It's amazing.
In the face of adversity, the lessons taught on the field extend beyond the track. Run your own race. Give it all you got. Then give some more. Because at the end, all you have is yourself.
SoCal Connected is made possible through the generous support of the Amundsen Foundation, serving the Los Angeles community since 1952.